By dehumanizing the hillbilly, the anarchist spirit which empowered poor folks to choose a lifestyle different from that of the state and so-called civilized society could be crushed, and if not totally crushed, at least made to appear criminal and suspect. However, the spirit of resistance and revolution that has been nurtured in many of us by generations of Kentucky folks who have chosen self-reliance and self-determination inspires us. It has provided the catalyst for my personal struggle for self-definition. Living away from my native place, I became more consciously Kentuckian than I was when I lived at home. This is what the experience of exile can do: change your mind, utterly transform one's perception of the world of home. Like many writers, especially Southerners, who have stayed away from their native place, who live in a state of mental exile, the condition of feeling split was damaging, causing a breaking down of the spirit. Healing that spirit meant for me remembering myself, taking the bits and pieces of my life and my heart and putting them together again, remembering my childhood. I was mapping the territory, discovering myself and finding home place, seeing clearly that Kentucky was my fate. My decision to make my home in Kentucky did not emerge from any sentimental assumption that I would find an uncorrupted world here. Rather, I knew I would still find here living remnants of all that was wonderful in the world of my growing up. Even though I had lived for more than 30 years, as my grandmother used to always say, "Gloria, how can you live so far away from your people?" Even though I had lived for so many years away from my people, I was fortunate that there was a place and home folk for me to return to, that I was welcome. Coming back to my native place, I embraced with true love the reality that Kentucky is my fate, my sublime home. Returning to the Kentucky landscape of my childhood, and most importantly, to the hills, I am able to reclaim a sublime understanding that living in harmony with the spirit, with the earth, renews the spirit. Coming home to live in Kentucky was for me a journey back to a place where I felt I belonged. But it was also returning to a place that I felt needed me and my resources, a place where I, as a citizen, could be in community with other folk, seeking to revive and renew our local environment, seeking to have fidelity to a place. Living engagement with both a specific place and the issue of sustainability, we know and understand that we are living lives of interdependence. Writing about the meaning of community, we return to the unforgettable home places of our past with a sense of covenant and commitment. M. Scott Peck shares in the book, The Different Drum, Community Making and Peace, that true community is always realistic. To be real in community, differences must be acknowledged and embraced. He explains, because a community includes members with many different points of view and the freedom to express them, it comes to appreciate the whole of a situation. And an important part of the reality of community and the realism of community is humility. Connected and committed to building community, we are called by a covenant of love to extend fellowship even when we confront rejection. You guys have to follow me on a day in Berea, you know. It's like everywhere I go, I have to give love. So yesterday I was with some old white man, what some people might call a redneck white man, outside my favorite thrift store. And I was saying to him, "Haven't seen you lately." I was like, "Come on, I gotta give you a hug." And I think about that, guys. I think about how black and white and brown and white don't cross boundaries in this culture. And also think about how racism affected the reality of touch. You know, when was the last time you touched and embraced someone different from yourself? Someone that you might be afraid will rebuff you. There are really many days that I go out and I talk to white folks who just ignore me, who just keep on walking like I didn't say a word. But I know Martin Luther King is happy with me because I am doing the work of building community. Committed to building community, we are called by a covenant of love to extend fellowship even when we confront rejection. We are not called to make peace with abuse, but we are called to be peacemakers. Of course, we cannot truly be peacemakers if we have not found peace within. For many folk who are disenfranchised and indigent in the Kentucky hills and hollers, peace comes not from material plenty, but from that sense of belonging on this particular place on earth, our hills and mountains. This peace must be protected. When we live in a culture that is daily warring against us, just as mountaintop removal destroys and decimates sacred ground, our souls are daily assaulted by imperialist, white supremacist, capitalist aggression. The challenge of these days is to be somewhere as opposed to nowhere, actually to belong to some particular place. Invest yourself in it. Draw strength and courage from it. To dwell not simply in a career or a bank account, but in a community. Once you commit yourself to a place, you begin to share responsibility for what happens here. When we work to protect our community as well as the earth, which is our witness, the ground on which we stand, as well as the earth, we have the conditions for harmony, fellowship, and peace. Those of us who left Kentucky ground to plant the seeds of our being elsewhere returned to the bluegrass state because we realized, as we made lives elsewhere, that it was this landscape, this earth, that nourished and nurtures our spirit. To me, the insistence that the best and the brightest of the Kentucky hillbilly country folk need to move elsewhere to become fully self-realized. I heard that all my childhood, that if I was going to be somebody, I was going to have to leave Kentucky. I was going to have to leave my Kentucky accent behind. Consequently, a major human resource is taken from this state. Symbolically, this is not unlike mountaintop removal or the mining of coal to go other places. Returning to Kentucky, making my life in a small town, I knew this was the end of my journey in search of home. Sanders shares in his essay, Settling Down, that it took him half a lifetime of searching to realize that the likeliest path to the ultimate ground leads to our local ground. And he means the land, weather, seasons, plants, animals, people. Boldly, he declares, I cannot have a spiritual center without having a geographical one. I cannot live a grounded life without being grounded in a place. Connecting home place to spiritual peace, he reminds us that, quote, in belonging to a landscape, one feels a rightness, an at-homeness, a knitting of self and world. Eloquently, these words express my feelings about being here, about living in the hills. You know, when I was a child, I grew up in Kentucky Hills, we had so much fear. And I didn't realize that until I came here and I bought my house in the hills that I have, and my family didn't want to come there because they remembered the tremendous racialized fear and fear of racial terrorism that haunted us in our youth. But I have found, you know, I always take the motto, like the queer motto, we're here, I feel that about myself as a black person in the hills of Kentucky. I am here. And there is nothing but love within me for the world around me. And usually it is what love does that is reflected back to me. You know, when some so-called redneck hillbilly men in the truck say, "Are you that colored lady that has that house on the hill? Well, we've been looking for you. We heard you was in Paris or New York, but we want to hunt on your land." And I have to take that moment of pause because the sexist female within me wants to say, "Okay." And then the revolutionary activist in me says, "No, thank you. You may visit, but I don't want hunting on my land. I am economically privileged to be able to keep my 15 acres green, pristine, always free from exploitation. I am called to use my resources not only to recover and protect damaged green space, but to engage in a process of hilltop healing. Although I come from a long line of Kentucky country folk, farming women and men, I'm having to learn my stewardship. I do not have a green thumb. I'm sure for every plant I keep alive, there are many that die. I am learning my stewardship, and I have more than a little help from my community. I am doing the work of self-healing, of earth healing, of reveling in this piecing together of my world in such a way that I can love, that I can be whole and holy. A world where I can fully embrace that Kentucky is my fate. Join me in that celebration. Thank you.
How lucky am I that Bell Hooks lives like three blocks away? It's one of the reasons to live in Berea. Please, we're going to bring some more chairs out. If anybody wants to come up here and set, you're welcome to come on up on the stage and set. Feel free to do that while I call up our next panelist. Our next panel is Where I'm From, Dialect and Accepted Classism. So I'll call up Amy Greene. Crystal Wilkinson is here. Is Pam Duncan here? And Gwyn Rubio. So they come on out, and y'all can consult your programs for their bios. Give them just a second to get situated. And please come on up on stage and get a comfortable seat. Y'all can come on. If you're leaving, we're going to go ahead and get started, so please do that as quietly as possible. And I'll get Amy and Gwyn. You want to sit here, Gwyn, because I don't know where Pam is. We're going to run a tight ship and keep it right on schedule. I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Amy, Crystal, and Gwyn. Please welcome them.
Am I? Am I the one? Okay. I forgot that I was the moderator. Sala said just come out and talk. So I was waiting for somebody else to do that. I think what we'll do, if it's okay with you all, is that each of us will just say something and then we'll engage in a dialogue. I wrote my little piece down, so I'll read it. It won't take long. So one of the things that when I was thinking about this, we address this so much as writers, this issue of where you're from, and I particularly deal with the dialect question a lot, both in my life and in my writing. I've always had to deal with this. So it becomes almost a thing where I had to conjure something up last night because it happened so much that I've become sort of jaded to it. And so I wasn't affected by the question. Instead, I started thinking about it, and then I got mad, and then I wrote this. Kentucky writer Gail Jones, who has shaped the way that I think about the Black Kentucky experience and the way that I process my own experience as a Black woman writer from Appalachia, says, "I'm not telling the story. The person telling the story is telling it." The way that I combat the stereotype of the dialect that represents my dual experience as an African-American Appalachian is to lend an unflinching eye to my characters and their experiences, to allow them in their full glory on the page and allow them to draw out their eyes, to twang, to be their own true authentic selves on the page. Hopefully not in a stereotypical way, but in a way that is true to them. After years of struggle, trying to rid myself of my own accent, trying to whitewash my writing so that it was more pleasing to the ear of the dominant culture, I've just decided that I'm paying homage to my most recent ancestors and even those who are more distant by allowing them to speak. They didn't get to speak when they were alive. They didn't get to tell their stories. So it's my job to allow them that space and time to speak to each other, to speak to me, to speak to the reader, to speak to the dominant culture at large. And I try to get out of their way and get out of my own way and allow that to happen. I don't often write directly to political or social concerns, but the act of writing these characters, of particularly relying on first-person point of view and drawing from the oral storytelling traditions of African and African-American and Appalachian culture, is what I do. I think that by making Black Appalachian vernacular the core of a writer's work, that itself could be seen as a revolutionary act. How much more revolutionary can you be than to give a country Black woman from a holler a platform on which she can tell her own story from her own mouth, using her own tongue, as though she is talking to her own people, when much of the world refuses to acknowledge that she even exists? Of course, it's imagination, but I've come to make it my business, my mission, in fact, to allow my tellers to tell. I think what's unfortunate is that often Black writers, Appalachian writers, too, are not given credit for their linguistic imagination, and that's a term that I also borrowed from Gail Jones. When I write in the voices of my people, I'm paying homage to my ancestors, specifically my matriarchs, the housekeepers, the granny women, the heart of Black Appalachian household, but I'm not just regurgitating my own reality. With Appalachian writers and with Black women writers in particular, there's always some suspicion that we can't create language or voice, that we can't invent a world in which people speak as we do. Some of the comments that are made to me, I couldn't imagine that other writers have these issues with the same intensity. When I'm writing fiction, I'm writing fiction. It's not cute that I write this way. It's not easy. It's a craft. It takes hard work. It took me more than 10 years to write my new novel. If a member of the dominant literary culture wrote a book about a Black woman in Appalachia overcoming her struggle speaking in vernacular, using dialect, he would be regarded as a genius. So I use dialect as a literary tool, as a conduit to my ancestors, and anyone who makes fun of them, is my, as my grandfather would say, is playing with fire. Welcome, Pam.
I'm sorry I interrupted you.
I don't know who wants to go next, but
I'll say okay. Something because you reminded when you said you got mad when you think, you know, I used to think, well, I would never want to write anything political or write with an agenda, but the older I get, the madder I get, you know. And I think when you're kind of pushed to the side, and you sense this as an artist, for me, I find myself writing about the outsider a lot. You know, writing about the you know, in my second novel, you know, I wrote about a one-eyed man who, you know, everybody kind of recoils from. I find myself drawn to those people, and I think it's that sort of anger. But you can ask the reader in this way to stand in somebody else's shoes and to have empathy for somebody they might not otherwise, you know, think much of. And so I find myself, you know, not intentionally and not setting out to, but using my fiction, my writing, as a tool to kind of say, you know, and kind of look at people outside the mountain, say, look at us, you know, and pay attention to us. We're not cute, you know. We're real, loving, human, flesh and blood people. And I think it's so important that we have voices, particularly artists coming out of Appalachia, because so often we're being defined by outsiders. You know, we're being defined by a media. They're telling our stories for us, you know. And so that's why a gathering like this is so vital and essential to our survival, really, you know, of our heritage, our oral histories. In my first novel, Bloodroot, I used the word green because I didn't realize what I was doing. I just knew I felt compelled to get the voices of the people that I've known and loved that raised me down on paper. I don't even think I knew what the word marginalized meant at that time. You know, I wasn't really thinking about it. But there's an urge there. They're part of my impulse as a writer, and my compulsion was to say, these people matter. I love them, their flaws, everything about them. I want to show you this complicated picture of home and these people you have these ideas about that have been defined by others, you know. So I think that, for me, part of the impetus to write, and there is this fine line when you're writing dialect and you're trying to capture the truth of these voices, because you know, you may end up doing the thing that you would least want to do, which is feeding into a stereotype or a cliche. And, you know, I had to be really, really careful with that. And I also had to, because you do have to at some point think of readability, but, you know, when my New York editor is telling me, you know, that doesn't make any sense, you know, people don't really talk that way, I can't help but bristle, you know. You have to kind of fight your battles there, too, to keep authenticity. But you know, I think where displacement begins is when we start to sort of buy into that kind of losing our accents and not honoring those family stories and those traditions. I mean, that's when we're gonna lose our home. We're gonna be disenfranchised. So, but that's how it manifests for me. Is I write the outsider.
Is it on? Can you hear me?
No.
I'm the one who would cut it off instead of on. Now? Okay. I'm not from Kentucky. I was born in South Central Georgia and grew up in South Central Georgia. I've been in Kentucky for 40 years. And my first novel, Icy Sparks, is set in Kentucky. And my husband and I came to Kentucky to live off the land. And we fell in love with the area and in the mountains, and fell in love with the mountains. And I always knew that Icy Sparks would be set in Kentucky. And that's because when we came to Kentucky to live off the land, which we could barely do because my husband is from Miami. You know, he has trouble figuring out how to screw in a light bulb. And so I'm from a rural area of Georgia, but I've never lived off the land. I grew up in town. But I knew Icy Sparks would be set in Kentucky because it was in Kentucky that I saw the natural world for the first time. And I had the wisdom as an adult to take in the natural world and not to take it for granted the way children will often. And so I knew I would set this novel in Kentucky. But I'm also not from Kentucky, so I had to hint at the dialect. I got it right sometimes and missed it on other times, but I always loved the way the mountain dialect. I thought it was just so beautiful to listen to and so musical. And I fell in love with Kentucky. I think if you fall in love with Kentucky and you come from the outside and you fall in love, you stay. But I think one reason my novel was taken by when Viking Penguin bought the novel, my editor, she loved the book, but I got a little bit of assistance, a little bit of luck from her assistant editor, who was from Louisville, Kentucky. However, her parents were from Pikeville. So we all need a little bit. This is a tough business, so you need a little bit of luck. And I don't know if I would have had that little bit of luck without a friend from Kentucky helping me out. So I agree with you about writing about the outsider. I think that's why I made Icy. She was from the mountains of Kentucky, but in a way an outsider because of what she's dealing with. So anyway, that's all I have to say.
Is that on?
Yeah.
Hello, I'm Pam. Okay, what are we supposed to talk about again? I saw y'all with those notes.
Crystal, do you have it? You're in charge.
I saw their notebooks and I thought, oh crap, I didn't prepare
it. It is.
It is. Where I'm from, dialect and accepted classism.
Yeah.
How do Appalachian writers deal with this?
I remember dialect and classicism. I was talking to my friend, and as I was driving up here this morning, Susan Leading Fox, who's a Cherokee, lives in Bryson City, and she said, well, don't let them forget about the very first Appalachians, which were the Cherokee. And I said, I won't. I said, I think Paula Nelson's going to be there. Is Paula here? I don't know if she's in here or not. I can't see. I think she'll remind us, too. I wish Susan could be here to sort of talk about the Cherokee language. But anyway, I forgot my train of thought. I was thinking about dialect and class, and I don't know if y'all know, I work at Western Carolina University, which is in Cullowhee, North Carolina, and apparently, even though we are an Appalachian school, they don't want anybody to know that. Unlike a great place like Berea, say, where you celebrate it, we don't even have any Appalachian. We have an Appalachian literature class, thanks to Dr. Mae Claxton, who's not even Appalachian. She's from South Georgia, but she loves the literature. But there's no Appalachian Studies program. They took away the building that was built for our Mountain Heritage Center, stuffed them in the library, and claim they're going to build a new space for it at some time in the future. We'll see. And so it's like they want to erase that identity because of all the students we get from Charlotte and surrounding urban areas. But oh, I remember what I was going to say about Susan when I was talking a minute ago. Is she said, where are you going? I said, this Appalachian symposium, Appalachian writers and people talking about culture and literature and stuff. And she said, you know, I grew up here in the mountains. She said, I never referred to myself as an Appalachian. And nobody I knew did either. We just said, we're from the mountains. And she said, if I was telling somebody who I was, I said, I'm Indian. She don't say Indian. She goes, Indian. I don't know if that's her way of a joke or if she really says it like it. She goes, and she said, and sometimes I might say I'm a hillbilly Indian. But she said, we never used the word Appalachian. She said, that was always an outsider's word for us. And I thought, yeah, that's true, because when I was growing up, we just said I'm from the mountains if anybody asked. And so I thought that was interesting that we're labeled, what Amy was saying, other people are labeling us and defining us, and so part of our jobs as writers from this region are to get it right, and because they're not. The South and Appalachia is not Duck Dynasty theme park or or Mayberry theme park. You know, it's real people, real lives. And but I went to school in Chapel Hill as an undergraduate, and I ended up staying there working just in clerical jobs for nearly 30 years. And I finally got a dream teaching job at Western Carolina about 7 years ago. And I thought, I'm finally going home. I'm going back where people will talk like me, because nobody in Chapel Hill talks like me, maybe one other person that I never met. And and they, you know, when I went to college up there, people made fun of me all the time. And so much so that without even knowing I was doing it, I started to assimilate and started erasing my voice, because I didn't want to be made fun of. And you know, when you're that age, you really care about what other people think. You get to my age, you just don't give a shit anymore. And, but yeah. If I could impart anything to my 18 to 22 year old students, it's that. It's like, just go ahead now and stop giving a shit what other people think. And but anyway, when I was at Chapel Hill, when I was an undergraduate, and I'd go home and my family would say, "Oh, look at her, she's getting above her raise and she's a college girl now." And it made me feel exiled and other, like Amy was saying. And but I wasn't conscious of all this exactly. I was just on a subconscious level of awareness, I guess. Then after I graduated, I got a job working in the School of Public Health in Chapel Hill. And every day I would deliver the mail in this other building. And there's this woman who's my friend now, but she was a secretary, and she was from Indiana. And, you know, we don't sound like them, they don't sound like us. And she was reading the paper, and she said, "Oh, look here, Pam, they're offering a class for UNC employees who want to get rid of their Southern accent." And I was standing, just something about that day, it was like a lightning bolt shot up through my body from the floor. And I froze, and I thought, by God, I am not getting rid of my accent. I ain't the one with an accent, you are. And, but I enjoy her accent too, now that I've forgiven her for. But you know, sometimes somebody's got to make you mad to make you pay attention to something. And so that made me pay attention to that. And I thought, I like the way we talk. I like the sound of it. It's like music. And, you know, and I saw that it was disappearing. And I thought, okay, I'm going to try to keep it alive if I can and be proud of my heritage. And so then, flash forward, you know, when I started working at Western, I thought, okay, there'll be a lot of people there. At least the students will sound like me. And, you know, I can get all these great stories from these storytellers in the mountains. No. I think me and Ron Rash are the only two people from Appalachia in the whole English department, except for the secretaries. Everybody else is from somewhere else, which there's nothing wrong with that. I sound like Jerry Seinfeld. There's nothing wrong with that. But, you know, sometimes me and Ron will be in the faculty meetings, and they'll get to talking about stuff, and we'll just look at each other and roll our eyes, and I don't know, it's just different. And I did not expect that, maybe a little bit from the faculty, because I don't have a PhD. I felt inadequate anyway, and so I didn't expect to feel at home with faculty, even though they're very nice. But I thought at least the students would, because a lot of them are from that area, but they all sound like TV. They all sound like they've all been assimilated. Resistance is futile. Except every now and then, one of them from way up in Robbinsville, which is real remote. If y'all have never been to Robbinsville, up around Fontana and that neck of the woods, that's more remote. I guess the only thing I can think that's saved their accent. In my first semester, there was this boy named Ren Millsaps, who I have high hopes for as a writer. He's teaching high school now. But anyway, he was from Robbinsville. He opened his mouth, started talking, and I nearly started crying. Because it was kind of like having Silas House sitting in the room talking. And it's like, oh, thank God, there's some of you here. And so maybe every semester I might have one or two. But also I've noticed when I go in to my freshman, I teach freshman comp every semester. And when I, first couple of classes, as soon as I start talking, I can hear these little hee-hee-hee-hee giggling. And I don't let it bother me. But, you know, they're laughing at the way I talk. And, you know, they're just ignorant. They don't know any better. I help them. My goal is to help them learn that just because I talk this way does not mean I'm ignorant. Just because sometimes I say ain't or yonder or whatever does not mean I don't know the correct way to say things. I can fake it. But this is my, you know, I'm trying to be myself with you people, and meaning in my class, you know, and I want you to be comfortable too, just like I am. And but there's that, there was just that article that came out, we're talking about, am I talking to them?
No, what? I want to hear this. What?
That article came out about dialect in the classroom and how students are ashamed. And I've noticed that in my classroom, that a lot of students with that strong accent, they won't speak up because other students will laugh at it. And they don't even try to hide the fact they're laughing at them. They laugh at them out loud, and I'm going to stop.
Well, I was going to say, I didn't know I was Appalachian. I didn't know what it meant until I went to school in Vermont. And I didn't think I had an accent at all. Like, I thought I was getting by with it, you know. And until everybody there was like, what? You know, everybody's like, could you repeat that? What are you saying? And there was this French-Canadian woman that I met, and she, at graduation, she brought her family and stood them in front of me and said, talk. And what she didn't know was I could not understand a word she was saying half the time either. So, you know, but I didn't buy into it somehow, though. You know, I held on to, because I would find myself being hesitant to speak, and I guess it is that Appalachian pride, you know, and so then I'd just say, ain't, or whatever, or haint, or what, you know. I would kind of push it because I resisted the assimilation and the embarrassment because, I mean, I love my people. I love my mom and dad, so if I deny my accent, I'm denying my parents in a way. I'm denying where I came from. So I never will. It's the same way that people will kind of ask, you know, when you have a book published, I've had people to ask me, well, I guess you're going to move to New York now, right? I'm like, no. And it's the same way that I'm not, you know, I'm going to stay who I am, you know.
I think as a young person, that's that whole, that everybody has to go through their stages of coming to love who they are. I went through that. Even though I didn't leave Kentucky, I went to Eastern Kentucky University, but I was from the mountains. But the thing that happened to me was being black and having this accent. And I admit that over the years I've been a chameleon because I get, at a certain point, you get tired of talking about it. You get tired. You know, Georgella has that beautiful poem, Where I'm From, but sometimes I get tired still of being asked that, and nobody asks you that. You know, when I walk into a room, especially when I had dreadlocks, there's a certain expectation about who I am and where I'm from. And then when I open my mouth, something else altogether happens. So I've been known when I've gone around different places in the country to changing it, and I spend a lot of time trying to curve my eyes and all of that. But even going to Eastern Kentucky University, people would come up to me and say, say something, say not, you know, or white, they wanted me to pronounce. And another word they always wanted me to say was water. I don't know, I don't get that one, but do you all hear something when I say water?
I don't hear a thing.
Maybe I should say, I don't know, who says water? I don't know, maybe somebody does, but. But I think there's a difference in, I hate that we're often seen as ignorant, having your accent, keeping your dialect is often seen as being anti-intellectual somehow. And that's a big issue for me, being able to speak how I want to, and, you know, I can speak standard English. I don't want to, so I don't. My characters don't want to, so I don't make them.
Now you hear me, right? Yeah, I hear me now. When I was getting my undergraduate degree, like ages and ages ago, at Florida State University, I had a class in linguistics, right? And the first thing my professor, this is in Tallahassee, said to me when I walked through the door and I opened him, "How you doing?" He said, "You kill that Southern accent or I'm not going to pass you." And that's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
And he said that to the rest, those of us who had a Southern accent. So that's pretty horrifying. I thought, well, if everybody talked the same, we'd surely be a boring world, wouldn't it? If we all spoke the way he spoke, which was kind of nondescript, you know, and kind of neutral. But so I understand that very well. And I think I've lost a lot of my Deep South accent, but.
I still hear it.
But,
haven't.
But, you know, when I go back, though, to South Central Georgia, and it kicks in again. And I'm glad.
I do that too. I think we're all chameleons. My children, when they were small, used to laugh at me because we lived in Lexington most of their lives, and I'm from Casey County. And so, as we made the trip, the children were small. I was a single mother. We'd stop quite often. We'd stop about every 20 minutes. It wasn't a very long drive, maybe an hour and a half, but I'd stop, and the kids would laugh because the closer I get to Casey County, when I'd stop and talk to people, the more pronounced my accent got. Mm-hmm. And even now, when I'm, and my partner Ron says the same thing, you must be talking to a family member. Or when I used to teach at Moorhead, the secretary was from deep in the mountains, and he'd say, well, you must have been talking to her all day long because my accent would be stronger when I came home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I guess we've got about 20 minutes. One of the things that I would love to hear you all talk about is how you reconcile, I guess, the truth of speech of our way of talking, and how do you make that literary? Do you have things that you do in your writing that's different from your speaking?
I think you do have to kind of make it readable, and you have to think, you know, when you're writing. I think I don't drop G's on the page, you know, and I don't put a lot of marks, you know. I think you can suggest the way that something, with the way a word sounds, without altering it in that way or making it unreadable and hard on the page, you know. I think you kind of have a responsibility to the reader to have that ease and flow, you know. So I think for me, when I'm writing it, it's a matter of sort of sprinkling it in, you know, a little bit, a whoosh here, you know, a haint there. But you know, I think that's my thing. I mean, it disturbs me a little bit if I see a constant barrage of, you know, apostrophes and dropping G's. So that's kind of my method, is just to suggest the music of the language without mm-hmm. going too far into it.
I believe in just suggesting too.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that'll work yeah. quite easily if you do it right.
Yeah, I wrote Moon Women. My first novel is all dialect because I was trying to capture that music of the way my people speak, and I just loved it. It's like Crystal, I didn't want them to talk. They didn't want to talk like that, and I didn't make them. But I wasn't, at that point, I wasn't thinking about my audience. And then the publishers, you know, even though they were in New York, they never said anything about it. The only thing they asked about was toward the end, they talk about a painter. She was afraid of the painter, and they said, why would anybody be afraid of a painter? But it was Panther. But the way my Nanny Price said it was Painter. And so little things like that. But basically, they were okay with it. But I've come to, after that, I came to learn that, I'd have people come up to me at readings from Moon Women, and they'd say, oh, now I get it. Because they had never heard it before because they weren't from here. And so I was making my writing inaccessible to people, not because they didn't want to get it or weren't, were prejudiced or anything. They just couldn't hear it their ear was deaf to it until they heard somebody talking. And so I've sort of backed off of, like what Amy was saying, I hope I didn't drop too many G's. I hope Lee Smith trained me not to do that, because she showed me one time I had dropped every G there was on the page and replaced it with an apostrophe. And Lee said, I want you to look here. See all those apostrophes? Now, doesn't that look like rain on the page? And all of a sudden it was, it did. And I thought, oh, crap. And so I hope I didn't drop many G's. But, you know, I was not using standard English and that kind of thing. And I really believe, and I'm trying, every time I write something, trying to do it more and more, is convey dialect through syntax, word choice, flavor it like you would, you know, when you're using cuss words. You don't want one every page. You just want to flavor it.
Right.
Or maybe y'all aren't supposed to cuss here. I don't know. I see a lot of students. Disregard that part. But you know, it's about when you start thinking about your audience, you got to think about accessibility. And also, I feel like with that first book, the publisher was, I keep thinking how to word it. But I look back now and think, God, I wish I hadn't done that. I wish I hadn't let them label me as hillbilly, because I can call me a hillbilly. But for them doing it, it was like they were, what am I trying to say? Help me.
Elitist? Or?
Yeah. And they were.
Or they were going to use it as a cute hook.
Oh, yeah, they wanted to scratch you behind hook. The ears. Uh-huh. You were adorable.
Yeah. That was it. So my agent said, you got to have something to sell yourself. Yeah. And that was it, apparently. And I let it happen. And I wouldn't do that today. And
what I don't understand is why I get tired of, Appalachian literature is considered regional literature. Southern literature is regional literature. Well, why is it that the only literature that's literature without that is writers from New York or from the Northeast? Yeah. You know, it's like the South, we get labeled with that.
Yeah,
and it gets very, I don't understand
that. Well, I'm proud to be from where I am, but I'm also an American writer.
Mm-hmm, right.
You know, this is America.
This is America, y'all.
You know.
Right, right.
I wonder if you all have had the same, if you've worked with a New York publisher, if you have the same experience that I've had. I mean, my editor, I love her, but she said, she calls me exotic. And I don't know quite how to take that, you know?
Uh-huh.
I'm not sure, but to her, I mean, I guess I'm exotic. But, you know, we do have these sort of disconnects. Like with Bloodroot, she said, you know, could you take some of the Jesus out? And I was like, I don't think so, because I think that's part of our, that's as much a part of our culture and our heritage as the language and everything. So, and you know, you said you wish you hadn't let them put you in a place in the beginning, and I did the same thing when Bloodroot came out, and they flew me around on a book tour, and I was doing all these interviews, and I made the mistake of saying I'd never been on a plane before one time. Which I hadn't. I had never been on a plane before I went to San Francisco. And I said that in one interview, and then in every other interview, so you never been on a plane before, huh? You know, it's like they wanted me to chomp on a hayseed, and, you know, they loved it. But even on NPR, you know, at Weekend Edition, I was on NPR, and I just, but because I was not confident, I played right into it, because I'm a people pleaser. I wanted to, so I gave them what they wanted, and so they painted me as this sort of naive, barefoot country girl, and I completely went with it, you know, and I have regrets about that, you know, and the one thing that Jackie Lydon, which I think she's great, and I don't think she meant anything by this, but she asked me, do I think that people who live in the real world, where we sip lattes and read our Kindles on the subway, would know what you're talking about? So she, and I think that's the attitude. New York is the real world, and the rest of us are just out here in flyover country, you know. I don't know how to get rid of that concept, but that's the idea, you know, and it troubles me.
I was told to take out food. Just too much eating. Just too much eating.
We eat a lot,
I mean,
okay?
We enjoy our food. It's just too much eating.
Yeah.
Is that y'all do is eat? Yeah. We eat a lot. We enjoy
our food. We like our gravy and biscuits, okay?
Right. I don't know. I know that I got a lot of flack with my accent, and then my editor calls me. She says, "Well, you know, we're trying to get everything ready for the dust jacket, but they've written, I guess, the people who do all that in publicity, is so badly written. Will you take over and write it, Gwyn?" I thought, "Uh-oh, I'm going to get in trouble for this ultimately." So I did exactly as she asked. I went back and tried to, and it was very badly written, and tried to rework it somewhat. And I can't tell you how many enemies I made for doing that, yeah. You know, and because the person with that draw can't do this, you know, right. It was that kind of, it's just a real bias, I think.
And there's a condescending. There's a level of condescension that mm-hmm. I'm not sure people from elsewhere deal with mm-hmm. in the publishing world. I mean,
I don't think so.
Because it's been my experience, and maybe it's other women's experience mm-hmm. too. Maybe it's a woman thing, but I do think it has to do with my accent a lot. I think that I'm often condescended to, mm-hmm. even with, you know. Even in I love my publisher, but even in that kind of world, I feel that. And I don't know if I have a chip on my shoulder. Maybe I'm, you know, maybe
no, you
I'm
don't.
Seeing that.
No,
it's real.
Okay. It's real. Okay. Good. Oh, good. I'm not crazy.
It's real.
I don't even know your story, and I know it's. I know
okay.
it's real.
Okay. Good.
Because it happens all the time. I mean, for me, I think I have a, you know, W.E.B. Du Bois talks about a dual consciousness of people of color. And I think I have like a triple consciousness, being African American, being Appalachian, and being an American. And I had to deal with that with all of my books. My publisher was in England, Toby Press, my original publisher. And I'm excited about some things that are happening with my books now, because I get to fix some of those mistakes where I had to choose my battles. Like, they changed a James Brown lyric. Because the James Brown lyric wasn't grammatically correct. I always think of that Lee Smith story about, I'm sure you all have heard it, that Lee Smith told a story about one of her New York editors said, "Where's the noun?" when she said so-and-so went to the double wide. They were like, "Double wide what?" So I've had a lot of those issues, you know, in both camps. Recently, my copy editor, and you all, I'm in mixed company, so you all are probably not going to get this one either, but I have a character who's African American, of course, and she's out in the rain, and I say something about her hair going back home. And my copy editor didn't get it. Anybody get that? How many people in the audience get that? Oh, good. All right, some of y'all got it. But there are all kinds of little things like that. And then you as writer end up being the stupid one, like, or they think, like, you've made a big mistake here. So you get these things with these exclamation points, like, you must be
question
dumb.
Marks all over the page.
Yeah.
That's what I get.
You didn't get it. She's African American. Her hair is straightened. It's raining. So her hair is kinking up. So it's going back home to Africa. So how do you all deal with, do you all have questions for us? I have one more question. How do you deal when something happens in public where you feel like you've been, particularly let's say you're on at a reading or a speaking event, and something is said that directly accosts you as an Appalachian? That sort of, like that question that was asked of this panel, you know, how do Appalachian writers deal with many people believing it's perfectly acceptable to demean Appalachians? One thing that happened to me in New York, we were almost doing the same thing talking about New York, but one of the things that happened in New York was somebody in the audience said, I just don't believe you. And I said, "What?" And they just, "I just don't believe you." And I said, "What do you mean?" And they said, "I just don't believe that there are black people in Kentucky."
Yeah.
And so I started naming, you know, people, and they said, well, yeah, in Louisville or Lexington, but I just don't believe that they're, you know, how do you all survive? I was raised well. So I just kind of acted like I wasn't hearing him because I was mad. I would have really been stereotyped had I hit him over the head with something, so I didn't.
Yeah, I think our conditioning keeps us from reacting the way we want to. I do think our raising, you know, as Southern people, and maybe particularly as Southern women, you know, we're raised to always be polite. So I'm always surprised when somebody is just blatantly ignorant. You know, like I was at a, so the surprise kind of takes me aback. So later I think of a million things I could have said, you know. But I was reading in Charleston, and there were a lot of people, like people who had retired there and come, you know, so it was a melting pot sort of people. And this man raised his hand. There was like a Q&A after my reading, and I don't even know what this means. He was just like, have you ever seen Deliverance?
Oh, gosh.
I was like, yeah. I've seen it, but I didn't know I didn't understand what the relevance, or was he trying to put me in my place? Was he trying to, you know, was it a sneaky way of telling me that I was a hillbilly? Or I'm still not 100% sure what the point of that was, but, you know, so I just moved on. But, you know, I kind of wish I had investigated further. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and because he was trying to put me on the spot, but I think a good way to, I think that can be reversed. And what I really wish I would have done is kind of tried to investigate his point of view and, you know, asked him, well, why do you want to know? You know, what do you mean by this? Mm-hmm. Because I think when we're taken aback and caught off guard, we try to deflect or pretend it didn't happen. But I think the thing to do is to confront it head on if we can stand in our, you know, just on our own 2 feet.
Yeah, and our power.
Stand in our power, exactly. And just, you know, kind of turn that spotlight around and let's talk about you and why you feel the need to ask me that question. Because I think that's the real question.
Or with a sense of humor, too.
Oh, absolutely,
helps.
Yeah.
I think I'm cutting this off.
How do you do that?
Yeah, with a sense of humor helps, I think. Yeah. So always people can take it a little bit better if you're kind of, you know.
Sugarcoat it a little.
Well, yeah. Yeah, laugh about it a little bit. Yeah, maybe it works better. There's a question, I think, out there. Chris. Mm-hmm.
It's all over. Yeah, I mean, it is all over, but I have to say that I'm going to disagree in that it's the same. Yeah. It's not the same. I really don't think that it's the same. I mean, everybody has it, but whenever you see a people all together being, and I don't want to bring current politics into this, but here I go. But
go for it.
With the things that are going on in this state, and the things that are going on with the county clerks and marriage equality, the thing I hate, you can imagine where my politics lie. I won't even say that, but what does bother me is the hillbilly comments. Whenever there's an opportunity, as you all know, even with sometimes our own kind, when people who are from Kentucky even come in and they do a documentary in the mountains, instead of showing the beauty, there's always, you know, here's kids drinking Mountain Dew, here's this, here's that. And I think we get it more. I don't know, maybe I'm from here, but I think you can be from New York, and there's something about, and we keep using New York, but it can be New York, California, anywhere where there is a large city, and you can recover from that. Appalachians are never allowed, in my opinion, to recover from it. That is a fight that we have all of our lives, no matter what your education is. You can be from Appalachia and have a PhD. You can have however many degrees, and if you stand on a stage and you say, I had Merlot last night, there is an automatic judgment.
No, you're right.
Automatic.
I don't know if this is on or not, but we need to have a break. I know some of you need to have a break. So we're going to break until 1:30 and come back for Eric Reese, Ann Shelby, Julia Watts, and Frank X. Walker talking about the personal as the political. Sorry to cut you off.
Rocking chairs. Do we get to keep these rocking chairs? They're nice.